Who is Richard Marquand?
Since starting this channel and my research into Wales's relationship with movies and Hollywood, Richard Marquand has become a bit of a hero of mine. Richard Marquand was born on the 22nd of September 1937 into the district of Llanishan in our capital city, Cardiff. He was the son of a politician, namely Hilary Marquand, who succeeded Aneurin Bevan as the health minister in the UK government in 1951. Richard's brother David Marquand was also a politician, serving as an MP in the Labour Party for 11 years and who is now a member of Plaid Cymru. And for any Americans or people outside Wales and the UK, Plaid Cymru is effectively the Welsh Independence Party. So who was Richard Marquand? Well, like a lot of the very best people, Richard was a supporter of Liverpool Football Club. When he was very young, he worked as a newsreader for one of Hong Kong's English language channels. Mostly, Marquand was a director, but also producer and writer, and by the sounds of it, a very enthusiastic Welshman. He started off making documentaries for the BBC and made numerous kids' films before his big break making The Legacy, starring Catherine Ross, Sam Elliott and Roger Daltrey. Marquand followed this up with a biographical movie titled The Birth of the Beatles, and this was released in cinemas across the whole world apart from the United States, where it premiered on television to mixed reviews. Despite this limited exposure to US audiences, Richard found himself in the director's chair for The Eye of the Needle, released in 1981, an adaptation of a best-selling espionage novel by Ken Follett, who was also born in Cardiff, 12 years after Richard. Before worldwide success as a novelist, Follett had a background in journalism also, for the South Wales Echo. Now, given that the Marquands seem to have been an influential and powerful family in the area of the south of Wales and its capital at that time, it's quite possible that this is somehow how Richard found himself helming this British movie produced by United Artists. I remember catching The Eye of the Needle on TV as a kid. Donald Sutherland's creepy and sinister performance stayed with me for a few days after I saw it, and watching this movie again in preparation for making this essay, it's clear to me that Richard Marquand had a considerable ability in building slow-burning tension and exploiting drama from human relationships. I recommend watching The Eye of the Needle, a best-selling novel adapted into an international movie and directed by Cardiff's most credible, if perhaps not the most celebrated, movie director. What it really demonstrates is Marquand's understanding of filmic tension and the human dynamic. This is probably why Richard then gets the call from one of the most powerful men in Hollywood. Sometime in 1981, George Lucas cherry-picks Richard Marquand, then aged 43, to direct what was perhaps the biggest movie event of all time, Star Wars: The Return of the Jedi. There are, of course, other much-noted reasons why Lucas needed Marquand. He had been ostracized by the Directors Guild of America due to their objections to his use of the opening crawls in both Star Wars and The Empire Strikes Back. Lucas left the Guild, which is effectively a director's union, and was therefore unable to hire any member of it to direct his movies. In short, Lucas needed a director not in the union. His original choice was independent director David Lynch, but when Lynch eventually dropped out, feeling the tone and style of the film was inappropriate for his needs, Lucas turned back to Richard Marquand. After Star Wars' huge commercial success, Lucas had taken a step back from directing his films and hired Irvin Kershner to direct The Empire Strikes Back. And I think it's fair to say that this decision is probably responsible for the continuation of the franchise, as when George did get back in the director's chair 18 years later, well, enough's been said there. The common opinion, and a very dismissive and simplistic one, is that Lucas simply wanted a puppet for Return of the Jedi, a small name who he could bend to his will. The image is of Lucas lurking in the background over Marquand's shoulder and spot-checking every decision he makes. But there's many reasons, which I'll outline now, why I just don't think this is the case. Firstly, it's not a secret that Richard Marquand, coming from a journalistic and documentary background, had absolutely no experience of using or developing special effects. If Lucas was looking for a glorified second or third unit director, he chose the wrong man, as I suspect he could have found a director outside the guild with far more experience in this area. This would suggest that Lucas needed someone of Richard's sensibilities to steer the finale of the film in its satisfying emotional direction. Secondly, I think it's fair to say that perhaps George delegated and controlled more of this production from an effects perspective more than anything else. If you read either of the two Making of Return of the Jedi books, both of which I have in preparation for this video, it's clear that Marquand was properly involved in many aspects of the film's creation from a storytelling, directing and aesthetic perspective. And I think what Richard says about himself and George kind of backs up why this would be the case. Lucas is known, after all, as being simply not an actor's director, a socially awkward and distant personality. And you could see why he would need someone of Richard's personality to direct the emotional high point and culmination of his franchise. If you have a look at the dialogue-heavy and dramatic scenes in Return of the Jedi, for me, they're all the best parts of the film, and they're all helmed by Richard. The diaries in the making of reveal the many parts of Jedi's story that Richard conceived. For example, Darth Vader's using of Leia to goad Luke Skywalker in hiding, perhaps the most emotionally tense high point of the film, was a script edit that came purely from Marquand on set.
If you will not turn to the dark side, then perhaps she will.
From reading the diaries, what's also clear is that Carrie Fisher clearly worked with Richard to feminize the character of Princess Leia. So, if you're looking for any one person responsible for Princess Leia's gold bikini, our man Richard, with the twinkle in his eye, could well be that man. If you also look at how Richard directs and elicits humour from the Ewok scenes compared to the rather pedestrian and sophisticated treatment of Jar Jar Binks by George Lucas 16 years later. For me, Return of the Jedi needed some of this light-hearted human touch to have the impact that it did and still does. The film's finale is still satisfying after 30 years, and our man Richard had a huge part to play in that. You can also check out his cameo and spoken contributions here inside the AT-ST with Peter Mayhew, and believe it or not, Richard also provided the voice for this android inside Jabba's sail barge.
You're a feisty little one, but you'll soon learn some respect. I have need for you on the master's sail barge.
From a collaborative point of view, it's also clear that Richard often worked with the same crew, which certainly seems to back up the image as an amiable and trustworthy fella. Marquand kickstarted the career of the well-respected director of photography, Alan Hume, whom he first worked with on The Legacy, The Birth of the Beatles, but who then went on to shoot The Eye of the Needle, For Your Eyes Only, Return of the Jedi, Octopussy, A View to a Kill, and A Fish Called Wanda. In terms of cinematography, Return of the Jedi is still the best looking film out of the entire franchise, and Richard's collaborative fingers are all over this Bourne fruit. Richard did have a career too after Star Wars. His next film was Until September for United Artists, starring Karen Allen, and most notably, Marquand was the director for the courtroom slasher movie Jagged Edge, starring Glenn Close and Jeff Bridges. For both these films, Marquand worked with his collaborator, editor Sean Barton, with whom he began an artistic relationship on The Eye of the Needle, which carried on into Return of the Jedi. The success of these collaborations absolutely contradict the notion of a proxy puppet in George Lucas's director's chair. Directing a Star Wars film for George Lucas, realistically, no one's gonna get a final cut, but this was a man who knew who and what he wanted on set and often got it. Barton and Alan Hume also worked on Hearts of Fire, which was known as the film which killed Richard Marquand. Hearts of Fire was released posthumously after Richard's death in 1987, so it's with a touch of sadness and regret that I talk about this film, because after watching it, you can clearly see how working on it would have been a stressful experience. Bob Dylan totally phones it in as a has-been rock star. It's notable from a Welsh perspective for a couple of locations down in the south, but this film really does not do Richard's talent any justice and doesn't serve as a fitting epitaph to the man's career. Boarding the train from Pannar to Cardiff on way to seeing Return of the Jedi in 1983 is one of my earliest memories. Certainly not then, but even growing up as a massive Star Wars teenager in a sci-fi obsessed household in the 80s and 90s, I had no concept of Richard Marquand the Welshman, who was born just up the road from me, until I started my research in 2011. Richard Marquand was married twice and had four children, one of whom, James Elwood Marquand, is also a film director and has spoken publicly to the BBC about his father's work on Return of the Jedi. Richard Marquand died from a stroke at his home in Penhurst, England, on the 4th of September, 1987, just 18 days short of what would have been his 50th birthday. He described himself as an emotional, sentimental Welshman with a twinkle in his eye. But how should we remember him? I'll pass on what I have learned about the man, one of the most prominent Welsh creatives of the 20th century, a man whose contribution to film has been seen by more people across the world than most directors could ever dream of, a kind, well-respected and loved artist who loved his family, his work and his country. The Force will be with him, always.